Let us join our voices in prayer. Here at Bethany, we have the tradition of saying the prayer of the day together in unison. You can find this prayer printed on your insert titled Today's Readings. Let us pray. God of love, giver of life, you know our frailties and failings. Give us your grace to overcome them. Keep us from those things that harm us and guide us in the way of salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from Ezekiel. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you mean by repeating this proverb concerning the land of Israel? The parents have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. As I live, says the Lord God, this proverb shall no more be used by you in Israel. Know that all lives are mine, the life of the parent as well as the life of the child is mine. It is only the person who sins that shall die. Yet you say, the way of the Lord is unfair. Hear now, O house of Israel, is my way unfair? Is it not your ways that are unfair? When the righteous turn away from their righteousness and commit iniquity, they shall die for it. For the iniquity that they have committed, they shall die. Again, when the wicked turn away from the wickedness they have committed and do what is lawful and right, they shall save their life, because they considered and turned away from all the transgressions that they had committed. They shall surely live. They shall not die. Yet the house of Israel says, the way of the Lord is unfair. O house of Israel, are my ways unfair? Is it not your ways that are unfair? Therefore, I will judge you, O house of Israel, all of you according to your ways, says the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions. Otherwise, iniquity will be your ruin. Cast away from you all the transgressions that you have committed against me, and get yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, O house of Israel? For I have no pleasure in the death of anyone, says the Lord God. Turn then and live. The word of the Lord.
This morning we sing responsively from Psalm 25.
To you, Lord, I lift up my soul. Thank you. of your goodness, O Lord. Hear our gracious cry, O Lord. Hear each sinner's plea. You lead the lowly in justice and teach the lowly your way.
A reading from Philippians. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord, and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. The word of the Lord.
I invite you to rise as we welcome today's gospel. The gospel according to the book of Matthew. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argued with one another, "If we say from heaven, he will say to us, 'Why then did you not believe him?' But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered, 'I will not.' But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same, and he answered, 'I go, sir.' And he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. By what authority are you doing these things? Who gave you this authority? After his ministry in the surrounding villages and throughout faraway regions, Jesus arrives in the city of Jerusalem. Jerusalem, where the temple sat on the hill. Jerusalem, the city that bore the heart of Jewish life and worship, tradition and history. The chief priests and elders stayed around the temple, ready to teach anyone looking for answers there. This was their calling, and this was their purpose. By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? It's very easy for us to hear these questions as a sort of challenge. The chief priests and the elders were challenging Jesus, right? They were prompting him, goading him into debate and missteps, right? If you have read much of the book of Matthew, you'll know Matthew does not go out of his way to paint the chief priests and the elders in a good light. But we know they are knowledgeable. They are well-versed in scripture and custom and tradition. They know the history of their religion and their people better than anyone. They take their faith seriously and regard it with the utmost importance. If we take a step back from our preconceived notions, if we take a step back from the story in our own context, is this a moment of challenge, or is it a moment, an opportunity for clarity? By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority? Authority is an important question. Who has authority? Who doesn't? Where does authority come from? Does our authority come from titles or experience, education, or from our history? Is authority something that can be measured, or is it a bit more intangible? In an age where access to news and information is constant and just a click away, in an age where you can learn a whole language from your computer screen and become an expert apparent in any given topic, the question of authority permeates through our everyday lives. By whose authority? How did they get that authority? What does it mean to have authority? Skepticism seeks clarity in a world where more content and information are produced and peddled than any one person could ever consume. It's overwhelming, isn't it? Perhaps a more specific example will help. Alex and I just returned home from a trip to France, a country that is so proud of their cuisine. Its quality, its freshness, and the passion with which it is prepared, I knew that I did not want a meal to go wasted on our trip. So naturally, I began a deep dive into restaurant reviews. 4.1 stars, they said. Hey, that's pretty good out of 5. 587 reviews, great sample size. So let's put our trust in Yelp. This restaurant was within walking distance. We were so very hungry after getting super lost in a museum. We were gonna go here. Oh, my friends, 587 people led us very astray. As the young folks say, that meal was super mid. Allow me to translate. The meal was so unremarkable, middle of the road, lacking in favor, it was entirely unimpressionable. Until I just brought it up to all of you. There were 587 reviews encouraging us to go and grab a bite in this cafe. 587. By what authority did those people say these nice things about this restaurant? Authority is a big question, and it goes beyond food reviews and even news releases and wellness advice that we take from social media from time to time. I'm so grateful for the chief priests and the elders of this story in Matthew. They are asking the question. Should there be any doubt about who Jesus is in this world, they are laying the groundwork to clarify his identity. By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority? If Jesus' authority comes from human things like Yelp reviews or critics or votes or popular opinion or experience or education or scandal, he is subjected to the same sort of confusion and misled intention that so often skews our perception of one another and of our institutions. By what authority? Who gave you this authority? Jesus comes not just as a man, but as God, God's self, human and divine, having authority in God and through God and with God. Jesus' authority is not subject to our own sorts of challenges and scandals, and this is good news. Jesus' authority is absolute. Jesus is Lord and Savior. Jesus is God with us. Jesus is God's love for us. Always. So our skepticism, it's not a sign of weakness, but it's a tool of our faith. Our curiosity is a means of formation, it's not a sign of doubt. Our challenge is a medium through which Jesus walks alongside us, remaining steadfast as we wade through this world looking for signs of God at work. We bring our questions and our doubts, our frustrations and our regrets before God because Jesus' authority is absolute and it cannot waver. God's love for you does not waver. Our story today ends with a parable, and I think it leaves us with something to ponder about authority. The first son said no. He would not do as his father commanded. The second said yes. Out of respect for his father's authority, perhaps, he would do as his father said. Yet, when the events of the day unfold, the first son is out working, and the second son is not. Is Jesus's authority, is Jesus as Lord and Savior something that we can only know? Or is to know Jesus as Lord and Savior, to know Jesus' authority as the Son of God, as God's God self, come to this world for the love of the world? Is that something that we do? Is knowing Jesus to live and to love like Jesus? Or is it just to know that Jesus is life and love? How we live and love in this world answers the question that continues to ring throughout life today. By whose authority? Our love and our life comes from God through Jesus Christ, shared by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so we do. We clothe the naked, we feed the hungry, we console the grieving, we trust one another. We cross over barriers and boundaries. We know our worth and we remind people of their own worthiness in Christ. We forgive because we know we are forgiven. To know Jesus is to know a love that has no boundaries. It is to know that love defies death itself. To know Jesus' love is to do Jesus' love. And it is to share that love with the whole world. Amen. Thank you. With the whole church on earth, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Remembering the caring and generous works of God, we pray for the church, creation, and the needs of our neighbors. We put our trust in you as we pray for the church. Give bishops, pastors, deacons, and teachers the gifts of wisdom and discernment. Be with them in bold truth and faithful witness. Merciful God, lead us in your truth as we pray for creation. Empower us to look to the interest of others as we make choices that impact the environment. Summon us to be advocates for healthy waterways, habitats, and air. Merciful God, lead us in justice as we pray for those in government, the military, and other positions of authority. Give them humble and willing hearts, looking to the needs of others. We pray also for our enemies. Merciful God, trusting your goodness, we pray for all caregivers and people who are sick or suffering in any way, especially Lynn Liebel, Terry DePlante, Karen Caswell, Lois Pinar, Bert Zenker, Jim Lankor, Bob Pawlowski, and those we name before you now, either aloud or in this moment of silence. Give them encouragement and consolation in your presence. Merciful God, teach us your paths as we pray for this congregation. Be at work in us and unite us in your love as we labor together for the sake of the gospel. Merciful God, we give thanks for all the saints who died, secure in the knowledge of salvation. Keep us fearless in our faith and certain of your resurrection. Merciful God, remember us according to your steadfast love as we offer these and the prayers of our heart, trusting in your compassion made known through Jesus Christ. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always. Please share signs of that peace with one another. Thank you.
God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table so that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending.
He was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we pray the prayer our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Here at Bethany Lutheran, we believe that Jesus has prepared a place for each of us at this table. Wherever you may be in your spiritual journey, you are most welcome to receive communion here. The ushers will guide you down the center aisle where you may choose to stand or kneel at our communion rail. If this is not accessible to you or you'd like to remain in your seat, just let the ushers know and we will bring communion to you. We have wine on the outer rims of these trays, and in the center we have a white non-alcoholic apple juice. We have gluten-free wafers available. Please just let me know if you would like or if you need that. Here at this table, we believe that God blurs the line between life and death. It's the greatest mystery of all that because Christ died and rose again, that death does not separate us from the people that we love. So when we commune at this table, we commune with the entire communion of saints, those living and those who have died before us. Welcome to Christ's table. Come and taste what is good.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Blessed be your name, O God, for we have feasted on your word, Christ Jesus, the joy and delight of our hearts. Strengthened by this food, send us to gather the world to your banquet, where none are left out and all are satisfied. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite any children worshiping with us today to come on forward. Welcome, welcome. Be right with you. Totally left something. Oh, I didn't. It's in here. Cool. How's everyone doing? Good. Well, that's good. How's your weekend been?
Good.
Good? Oh, it's been a little rainy. Has anyone done anything outside in the rain? Me neither. Welcome, friends. Come on up and sit down. So, raise your hand if you were in Sunday school today.
Me.
Me? How was Sunday school today?
Good.
Could you share with us a little bit of what you did? Yeah, sit right here. It's a great spot to sit. Thank you. That was so kind. Oh, what did you learn in Sunday school today? What'd you do?
We learned about everybody should get paid the same.
Ooh, everybody should get paid the same.
And also, we was like crafting on cardboard blocks.
Ooh, crafting on cardboard blocks. That sounds fun. Yeah, what'd you guys learn?
About paying each other.
That sounds great. Obeying. Oh, thank you. Oh, obeying each other. Ooh. Did you learn a lot? Yeah.
This is just like an art thing. And put your art things inside.
Oh,
here.
That's super convenient. We'll have to figure out where we go shopping. Do you guys want to know what we did in church today? You do? Really? I bet we had more fun than you. Not possible. In church day, we heard a story about Jesus talking with some people in an important city. They were important people, and they were like the experts on, this is a microphone. It makes me talk loud. So, and they were the experts. They knew everything. And so Jesus came into the city, and he was like, oh, hey, I know some stuff too. And they were like, excuse me, Jesus. Do you think Jesus knows a lot of stuff? What are we on? Jesus knowing a lot of stuff. Jesus probably knows a lot of stuff. Yeah. And so today we heard a story where people had questions about, Jesus, why do you know as much as you do? And we learned that this is a really great question because it gives us an opportunity to know who Jesus is. So what do you know about Jesus? Could I have one of you sit on this side of me? I'm just feeling this spot right here is just a little uncomfortable, so could someone sit over here because I just need to scooch this way. Oh yeah, right over here. Perfect. This allows me to be so much more comfortable. I appreciate it. Yes, I have no authority here. Oh, awesome, thank you. So what do we know about Jesus? Yes.
He created the world.
That's pretty authority-like. What else about Jesus? Do we talk about Jesus being related to anybody?
Yeah.
Yeah, who do we talk about Jesus as? The son of?
Me.
The son of you. Close. The son of God. And so this question that people had about Jesus, about who are you and why do you get to know all these things, is that Jesus is the son of God. And so it's a great question to have. Why Jesus? And so it's okay when we have questions about Jesus because it gives us the opportunity to know the answer. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is love. Jesus always has our back. Jesus is steadfast. So whenever anyone has questions, we kind of celebrate that because it gives us an opportunity to know God is always with us. Pretty cool, huh?
Yeah.
Do you think that we could say a prayer all together?
Yes.
Perfect. Let's stand up. Praying is big business. All right. Oh, Oh my. Oh, your shoe fell off. That's no good. Perfect. Stretch them out nice and wide. Stretch them up nice and tall. Should we touch our toes? All right, that looks so easy. Wow. All right, stretch them out nice and wide, and let's wrap Jesus into a hug. And everyone is invited to repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for today. Thank you for questions. So we get to know Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right, thank you all for coming up here. You can head back to your seats. And I just have a few announcements for everybody else. One, so for a couple months now, if you've been worshiping with us, you'll have noticed that we have a new baptismal font in our space. This happened over the summer. This baptismal font was built with love and care by our own Steve Lindahl. If you've been here even longer than me, you'll recognize the stained glass pieces in here from a window that used to exist in that back corner before the elevator was put in. You will have to ask someone else about that year more specifically. But this is a great example of the ways we can take, the way God takes old things and is always making them new. So next week, now that we're back into the full swing of Sunday school and confirmation, we're going to bless this baptismal font. So I invite you all back. It was in good use this weekend as we remembered baptism accompanies us from birth to death. And so come back next week, we're gonna bless that. If you have ever walked into a new church building before or gone to a different church for service, you can know that it feels a little uncomfortable the first time you walk in. And a big thing that helps with that discomfort is someone saying hello to you. Well, we are in need of more people to say hello at our worship services. It's very easy. It involves you coming 15 minutes before worship and saying hello to people as they walk in the door. There is a sign-up sheet in the back on our bulletin board if you're interested. Just show up 15 minutes early and we'll make sure you're set up and taken care of. So we are looking for those friendly faces and those greeters. Also, take your announcement sheet home and read a little bit more about our crisis fund. Our crisis fund ministry meets people when they are having the worst days of their life, when there is a house fire, when there is a job loss, and that crisis fund meets people to help get them through. And so read more about our crisis fund. Let me know if you have any questions, but this is a ministry that needs a little bit more help for us. So if you're at all interested, please let me know. Wow, we've done a lot together today. We've prayed together. We've heard the word of God proclaimed. We've received the bread and the wine. And now we go out into the world to share a little bit of that active love, that doing love that God shares with all of us. So I invite you to rise to receive this blessing. And now that I have your extra special attention, confirmation students, after the service, you can head over to the education building, and there are lights on in the rooms that we are going to be in. So follow the signs, and if you get super lost, I'll find you. And so I'll meet you over there soon. All right, please receive this blessing. The God of glory, Jesus Christ, name above all names, and the Spirit who lives in you, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
at work in you